Good morning, students. Here we start with the gross anatomy of the peritoneum. So in the first segment of this gross anatomy of peritoneum, we are going to understand the peritoneal folds. Before we understand the peritoneal folds, if we draw over here, this is the cross section, this is the generalized cross section of the abdominal cavity. In this cross section of abdominal cavity, now if we draw the peritoneum, it is a serous sac. It is the largest serous sac in the body, peritoneum. There is a definition of peritoneum. The largest serous sac within the body, and it will cover the parietes. These parietes, the parietes means the body wall. Here I am drawing the peritoneal lining. So it will cover the parietes, that is the body wall. If this is the cross section of the body wall, abdomen, this is the anterior part of the abdominal wall, these two are the lateral parts of the abdominal wall, and this is the posterior abdominal wall, cross section. Now inside the peritoneum, it is a serous membrane, it is a serous part which will line the parietes. Parietes means the body wall, this is the body wall. And then inside, it will be reflected over the visceral or different viscera of the abdomen. Now here, if I draw the cross section of a particular viscera, this is the cross section of a particular viscera, and let us take this as intestine. So this is the cross section of the intestine, that is the small intestine. And we can see that this peritoneal, the serous membrane, which we have lined the parietes body wall, will be reflected on the viscera also. It will cover the viscera also. So therefore, our generalized peritoneum, the serous membrane, which is lining the inner part of the parietes, the body wall, will be reflected even on the viscera, and it will cover the viscera. So therefore, our peritoneum is divided into parietal peritoneum and visceral peritoneum. What is parietal peritoneum? The parietal peritoneum is the serous layer which will line the inner side of the abdominal wall. So this is the abdominal wall. The abdominal wall is called the anterior abdominal wall. These are the lateral abdominal wall. This is the posterior abdominal wall. So these abdominal walls, they are called parietes. So therefore, the layer of peritoneum which will line the parietes, which will line the abdominal wall from inside, is called parietal peritoneum. So this is the parietal peritoneum. And the layer of peritoneum, where my finger is there, which will cover the viscera, all the different viscera. Since this is a cross section of the abdomen, we have shown the cross section, that is only one viscera, that is intestine, small intestine, a section passing across the small intestine. So the layer of peritoneum, which will cover the viscera, will be known as visceral peritoneum. So therefore, parietal peritoneum will be reflected upon the abdominal viscera and will cover those viscera and will form visceral peritoneum. The entire peritoneum is very easy, very simple, and very interesting to understand. So this is the beginning of the peritoneum. We are understanding the lining of parietal and visceral peritoneum. So it is basically very simple. The parietal peritoneum will be reflected on the viscera, different visceras of the abdomen, to form visceral peritoneum. And as they are reflected, you can see here, this is the reflection. Now this viscera, which are covered by visceral peritoneum, will be attached to the posterior abdominal wall. This is the posterior abdominal wall with the help of peritoneal folds, several peritoneal folds. So this portion will form here, this portion will form peritoneal fold, or it will be known as peritoneal ligaments. So the portion of the peritoneum which will suspend the viscera, in certain cases it will suspend the viscera or will attach the viscera to the posterior abdominal wall, that peritoneal lining will be known as peritoneal fold or peritoneal ligaments. Now therefore, there will be a cavity which is formed between the parietal peritoneum and visceral peritoneum, and that cavity, this is the entire cavity, that cavity is called peritoneal cavity. So peritoneal cavity is a potential space. Once again, I repeat, peritoneal cavity is a potential space which is present between parietal peritoneum and visceral peritoneum, and it is filled with capillary layer of fluid. it is filled with the capillary layer of the fluid. So this is a basic concept of the parietal peritoneum and visceral peritoneum. Now we move further. Parietal and visceral peritoneum, give the characteristic features of the parietal peritoneum and visceral peritoneum. Many times it is asked in one mark question answer, many times it is asked in MCQs. For example, now parietal peritoneum, now this is the parietal peritoneum. Remember, it is developed from somatopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. So it is developed from somatopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. MCQ or one mark question answer. What about visceral peritoneum? It is developed from splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. Now this, during our embryology classes, we have understood this. So therefore, visceral peritoneum is developed from splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. Now second point. Parietal peritoneum is supplied by somatic vessels and nerves. Remember, it is supplied by somatic nerves as well as vessels. This is parietal peritoneum. What about visceral peritoneum? The visceral peritoneum will be supplied by autonomic nerves, and also it will be supplied by the various vessels. So therefore, this visceral peritoneum, as it is supplied by autonomic nerves, it will become insensitive. So therefore, this is a common MCQ which is generally asked, routinely asked. Visceral peritoneum is insensitive to pain, tactile and thermal sensations. So it is insensitive to the pain, the tactile as well as the thermal sensations. This is very important. So visceral peritoneum, as it is supplied by autonomic nerves, it will be totally insensitive to the pain, thermal and tactile sensations. Whereas parietal peritoneum, as it is supplied by somatic nerves, so therefore it will be sensitive to the pain, it will be sensitive to all the cutaneous modalities of sensation. So it will be sensitive to pain, thermal, tactile, etc. It will be sensitive to all the cutaneous modalities of sensations. That is parietal peritoneum. Whereas visceral peritoneum, totally insensitive because it is supplied by autonomic nerves. So these two or three points about parietal and visceral peritoneum are very important. And now we go a step further. Now we want to understand the entire peritoneal cavity of the abdomen, how it is lining. In order to understand the entire peritoneal cavity of the abdomen, we shall draw one diagram which is given in all the textbooks and which is a very important diagram, that is the sagittal section of the abdominal cavity. Sagittal section of the abdominal cavity. So please draw alongside with me. That is what we are going to understand. Now here we shall draw, this will be the anterior abdominal wall. And over here, this will be the posterior abdominal wall. So here I will write simply anterior abdominal wall. And over here, the posterior abdominal wall. And similarly, lower down here, I will draw cross section of this pubis bone. And over here, I will draw the cross section of the sacrum. So, pubis and sacrum, sagittal section of the abdomen. Now we are going to draw the various viscera within the abdominal cavity. This is the general diagram, which is very important, this to clear the fundamentals or the concepts of the peritoneum. So therefore, we are going to draw now the lever. First, we are going to show the lever. Remember, this is a sagittal section. This is the lever. After drawing the lever, we are going to draw over here the stomach, again sagittal section only. Then we are going to draw on this side, let us draw, this will be the transverse colon. Just below that we are going to draw the small intestine, that is the coils of jejunum and ileum, sagittal section. And we are going to draw over here this will be sigmoid colon. After drawing this, now we are going to show the lining of the peritoneum. Very simple. The lining of peritoneum, we start with, first let us start with the yellow color. When we start, we shall start, but before we start, let us draw over here. This will be the bladder. Here we draw the bladder, and where we show seminal vesicle also. And then we are showing over here, let us show rectum and anal canal. So this one will be urinary bladder over here, and the rectum with anal canal. Now yellow color I am using for parietal peritoneum. When we start with the space between urinary bladder and rectum. So rectovesical pouch, this is the rectovesical pouch, and this is the parietal peritoneum lining the anterior abdominal wall. It will go upwards, and then it will be reflected on the liver, from the liver to the stomach in the form of lesser omentum. Then it will cover the stomach, and then after covering the stomach, it will go down and will cover a part of the mesentery of the transverse colon, that is transverse mesocolon, and then it will cover the entire small intestine, and then it will cover the sigmoid colon, and finally it will cover the rectum and form the rectovesical pouch. So therefore, this is the rectovesical pouch. This lining is parietal peritoneum. The parietal peritoneum covering all these different viscera. Now we come to the entire visceral peritoneum, which will also cover this viscera. Remember, the parietal peritoneum, of course, it is covering, but as it is reflected on this viscera, this parietal peritoneum will become visceral peritoneum. So this parietal peritoneum, as I have lined the abdominal wall, will cover the viscera as visceral peritoneum. The parietal peritoneum will cover the viscera. When it covers the viscera, liver, stomach, transverse colon, sigmoid colon, the small intestine, sigmoid colon, it will be known as visceral peritoneum. Very simple. So parietal peritoneum covering the wall, visceral peritoneum covering liver, stomach, transverse colon, small intestine and sigmoid colon. The same parietal peritoneum is reflected on the viscera as visceral peritoneum. Now we can see that in this sagittal section, the lining of parietal and visceral peritoneum we have understood. But now the entire peritoneal cavity, when we open in dissection, when we open the abdomen in the dissection by reflecting the skin, we see that when we open the peritoneal cavity, we see that the entire peritoneal cavity is divided into two main parts, two major parts, cavity of greater sac and the cavity of lesser sac. Now the cavity of the greater sac and lesser sac, both the cavities will communicate with each other through one small opening. Before we understand that opening, let us understand these two cavities, greater sac and lesser sac. Yellow color, wherever I have used as parietal peritoneum, and as it is reflected on this viscera as visceral peritoneum, this is the visceral peritoneum reflected on the viscera. This enclosed cavity where my hand is there is called greater sac. So therefore here simply I will write this as greater sac. Lesser sac, the lesser sac cavity will be, if I use this green color, the lesser sac cavity is present behind the stomach and it will extend beyond the stomach also. So that portion of the lesser sac, here I am drawing, it is present behind the stomach. And finally, now here, if I want to prolong this, simply prolongation, so that later on this becomes the greater omenta, which I am going to explain it to you. Now here, this is how green color I am using to show the cavity of lesser sac. And here we complete the cavity of the lesser sac. So green color, wherever I have used, this is the cavity of the lesser sac. So therefore now, the cavity of lesser sac, it is present behind the stomach. and it will extend beyond the stomach also, above and below. As it extends below the stomach, along with greater sac, here it will form a fold of peritoneum that I am going to discuss. That fold is called greater omentum. But inside the cavity which is present, which is extending, this cavity is the cavity of lesser sac. So very simple, the cavity of lesser sac is a part of peritoneal cavity which is present behind the stomach, but it will extend above and below the stomach. It will extend beyond the stomach. Here also it will extend above, lower down also it will extend below. Now, considering this lining of the peritoneum, the entire peritoneal cavity of the abdomen, it has come in this diagram, is divided into cavity of greater sac and cavity of lesser sac. This is the exact abdominal peritoneal cavity, which is divided into two main cavities, the cavity of greater sac, cavity of lesser sac. And cavity of greater sac, we already know that we have lining the parietal peritoneum, and as it is reflected on the viscera, it becomes visceral peritoneum. Very simple. This is the pattern of reflection. Lesser sac present behind the stomach, and we have shown the lining of the lesser sac also. So now it is very clear that the entire peritoneal cavity is divided into greater and lesser sac, the two main cavities of peritoneum. Very clear at this point. Remember, liver, stomach, transverse colon, small intestine, sigmoid colon, sagittal sections. Now we are going to move ahead, one more step forward. The cavity of lesser sac and greater sac are communicated by a small foramen of Winslow. And that foramen of Winslow, here if I put this here, this foramen of Winslow is also called adductus to lesser sac. The other name of foramen of Winslow is adductus to lesser sac. So therefore, that adductus to lesser sac is present in the right free margin of this fold. And this right free margin of this fold here, this becomes the foramen of Winslow. And this right free margin of this fold is called lesser omentum. So what is lesser omentum, which I am going to explain? It is a peritoneal fold only, which is present between liver and stomach. So this is the lesser omentum, where my finger is there, a peritoneal fold here, yellow and green color, the peritoneal fold connecting liver with stomach is called lesser omentum. So therefore, in the right free margin of lesser omentum, we have shown that arrow, that is the communication between the cavity of lesser sac with the cavity of greater sac. And therefore, it will communicate from here, it will communicate into the generalized greater sac. The cavity of lesser sac will communicate into greater sac through foramen of Winslow. Other name of foramen of Winslow is adductus to lesser sac or epiploic foramen. It is also known as epiploic foramen. So here if we mention this as epiploic foramen or foramen of Winslow or adductus to lesser sac. What is epiploic foramen? What is adductus to lesser sac? Or what is foramen of Winslow? Always asked in MCQs or one mark question answer. Very interesting, very important also. So therefore, boundaries. What are the boundaries of this foramen? Although this foramen will be discussed in later part in detail. Now here, anteriorly, this foramen is bounded by the right free margin of lesser omentum, anteriorly. Posteriorly, now here in this diagram we have not shown. Posteriorly, basically, in the posterior abdominal wall, there will be location of inferior vena cava. Superiorly, there will be a part of liver, here where my finger is there, and this part of liver is called caudate process of liver. These are the boundaries of epiploic foramen. Once again, anteriorly, right free margin of lesser omentum, posteriorly, inferior vena cava in the posterior abdominal wall, superiorly, caudate process of liver. And what is epiploic foramen? It is a small foramen, which is also known as foramen of Winslow, which will connect the lesser sac with the greater sac. And where is it present? In the right free margin of lesser omentum, or behind the right free margin of lesser omentum. Understanding these two cavities, now we move to third stage, organs. You can see here that all the organs, whatever we have drawn here, they are intraperitoneal organs. So therefore, by the lining of the entire peritoneum, through which we have divided the peritoneum into cavity of greater sac, cavity of lesser sac, which is lined by peritoneum, the organs in the abdomen, that is the viscera in the abdomen, are divided now into two categories, intraperitoneal organs an extra peritoneum within the peritoneal lining. As you can see here, these are intraperitoneal organs. So name the intraperitoneal organs: liver, stomach, transverse colon, sigmoid colon. This is sigmoid colon, small intestine. Once again, liver, stomach, transverse colon, small intestine, that is coils of jejunum and ileum, and sigmoid colon. These organs will become intraperitoneal organs, along with spleen, which we have not drawn here in this diagram because this is a sagittal section. Which are extraperitoneal organs? Those organs which are lying outside this peritoneal lining or outside this peritoneal cavity. And most of those organs are lying in the posterior abdominal wall, that is the space which is present where my hand is there, the space which is present between the parietal peritoneum here and the posterior abdominal wall. So the space which is present behind the parietal peritoneum and in front of the lumbar spine, this is the lumbar spine, here there will be presence of lumbar spine. So this space becomes retroperitoneal space. What is retroperitoneal space? The space which is present behind the peritoneal cavity. And that retroperitoneal space is also known as extraperitoneal space. It is a part of extraperitoneal space because it is present behind the peritoneum. And there are certain organs, there are certain viscera which are present here in the retroperitoneal space which are not covered with peritoneum, as of these organs which are intraperitoneal. Name those organs. Those organs which are lying in the retroperitoneal space, where my finger, with the help of finger I am tracing here, retroperitoneal space, those organs are pancreas, kidneys and adrenal glands. And also, if you consider duodenum, then except the proximal part of first part of duodenum, the entire duodenum is retroperitoneal. It lies behind the peritoneal cavity. And ascending colon and descending colon, that also becomes retroperitoneal. And you can see over here, we have drawn rectum and urinary bladder. They also become rather extraperitoneal. So therefore, these organs, whichever I have named them, they become extraperitoneal organs or retroperitoneal organs. So where will the pancreas be lying? The pancreas will be lying somewhere over here. This becomes the pancreas, retroperitoneal organ. Similarly, there will be presence of kidneys and adrenal gland. They are also retroperitoneal organs. Similarly, there will be ascending colon, descending colon, retroperitoneal. They lie behind the peritoneum, not transverse colon. Transverse colon becomes peritoneal, intraperitoneal. And the duodenum, except the proximal first part of the duodenum, the entire duodenum becomes retroperitoneal behind. So this is the generalized concept of intraperitoneal organs and extraperitoneal organs, which are also retroperitoneal organs. After understanding this concept, we move to the classification of peritoneal folds. What are the classification of peritoneal folds? So in the classification, now here, if I classify the peritoneal folds, we now know that the viscera, as they are covered by peritoneum, they will be covered in such a way that they become peritoneal folds. So all these are peritoneal folds where my finger is there. See here, these are the peritoneal folds. They are suspending the viscera, sigmoid colon, small intestine, transverse colon, even this fold which we have made here, this also becomes peritoneal fold. Now, how do you classify these peritoneal folds? How do you understand these peritoneal folds? We classify the peritoneal folds into, number one, omenta. Now, omenta is plural word. Singular is omentum. Omenta are those peritoneal folds which will connect the stomach with the other viscera. Once again, omenta are those peritoneal folds which will connect stomach with other viscera. For example, omenta are lesser and greater omentum. So here, now we shall name this particular structure is called lesser omentum. It is a fold of peritoneum connecting the liver with the stomach. This particular structure, now we shall name this as greater omentum. So this fold is greater omentum connecting the stomach with the transverse colon. So this is the greater omentum, this is the lesser omentum. Very clear, keep it simple, do not complicate. Lesser omentum, greater omentum, and they are connecting stomach with other viscera. Then second type in classification of peritoneal folds, first is omenta, greater omentum and lesser omentum. Second will be, there will be presence of mesenteries. Now what are mesenteries? Basically, the definition of mesenteries will be those peritoneal folds which will suspend the viscera from the posterior abdominal wall. So therefore, mesenteries are those peritoneal folds which will suspend all this viscera with the posterior abdominal wall. Very simple. So therefore, give an example. Here we have an example. This particular fold here is known as mesentery of small intestine because it is suspending the small intestine from posterior abdominal wall. So this is the mesentery of small intestine. Similarly, in case of transverse colon, that mesentery is known as mesocolon. So here, see here, this particular fold will be known as transverse mesocolon. So this particular fold becomes transverse mesocolon. And this transverse mesocolon is a peritoneal fold which will suspend the transverse colon from posterior abdominal wall. So it is a mesentery only, but it is known as transverse mesocolon. Similarly, sigmoid colon, there is a fold, this fold, which is suspending the sigmoid colon from the posterior abdominal wall, and it is known as sigmoid mesocolon. This will be known as sigmoid mesocolon. So this is the second type of classification, mesenteries. Now, third type of the peritoneal fold, third variety of peritoneal fold. Second variety is mesentery. First is omenta, second is mesenteries. Third variety is ligaments. What are ligaments? Now there are certain peritoneal folds which will connect one viscera with other viscera. Those peritoneal folds which connect one viscera with other viscera, so many of them. Let us name a few. They are liver, we are having falciform ligament, coronary ligaments. So therefore here we can just mention the falciform ligaments of liver, the coronary ligaments of liver, they are a part of peritoneal folds. Then we come to gastrosplenic ligament, leno-renal ligament. What is gastrosplenic? Fold connecting stomach with the spleen, which we have not drawn in this diagram because this is the sagittal section. We cannot show spleen in this sagittal section. We can show in a coronal section. That is what in later stages we are going to draw and we are going to show. So there is a ligament connecting stomach with that of the spleen. That is gastrosplenic ligament. That will also come under this category, gastrosplenic ligament. And there will be a ligament connecting spleen with the posterior abdominal wall. That will be known as the leno-renal ligament connecting spleen. That is L-I-E-N, lean. Spleen is also known as lean, Latin word. So, leno-renal ligament connecting spleen with the posterior abdominal wall. All these are examples of the third variety of peritoneal folds, that is the ligaments. So, now we are quite aware that in this abdomen, our abdominal cavity, we now know that it is divided into greater sac and lesser sac. We know the lining of parietal peritoneum as well as visceral peritoneum. And now we have classified the entire peritoneal folds into three different categories: omenta, mesenteries, ligaments. And we know the name of these structures. Now we come to detail. Now, in detail, very short, what will these folds transmit? Now these folds, for example the mesenteries, they will transmit the nerves and blood vessels. They will transmit various nerves as well as blood vessels. All these folds will transmit the nerves and blood vessels. So here, this is how they are innervating the viscera. So these peritoneal folds, they are transmitting the vessels and nerves. But it is not that all the peritoneal folds will transmit the nerves and blood vessels, no. There are several peritoneal folds which will transmit the nerves and blood vessels, and there are several peritoneal folds which will transmit only arteries. One mark question answer, sometimes it is asked, name those peritoneal folds which will transmit only the arteries. Those peritoneal folds are left gastropancreatic fold and right gastropancreatic fold. We will learn in detail when we discuss the detailed part of lesser sac. Now, lesser sac is also called omental bursa. So, when we discuss this lesser sac or omental bursa, we are going to discuss inside the lesser sac the presence of the left and right gastropancreatic fold. So, these two pancreatic folds will have presence of arteries. In one of them, there will be left gastric artery. In another, there will be the only presence of another artery. So, therefore, these are the peritoneal folds which will have presence of only arteries. One of them will have left gastric artery, left gastropancreatic fold, and in the right gastropancreatic fold, it will have hepatic artery. So, therefore, this is about the peritoneal folds which will transmit several structures. Now, we move to embryological basis of understanding of these folds. How these folds have formed, why this peritoneum has developed. For that, only a generalized diagram. Now, supposing, please come on this side, we'll take the help of this much side here. If I draw the foregut, and then if I draw over here the midgut, and then if I draw over here the hindgut. Now, once again, foregut, over here midgut, and over here hindgut. So, I will write here foregut. This I will write here, mention this as midgut, and over here I will mention this as hindgut. Very simple. In embryological terminology, how these peritoneal folds are developed. Initially, the foregut, midgut, hindgut is in the form of a tube that we have understood during embryological lectures of the development of digestive tract. This is just for a revision. In order to revise all these terminologies, how, in order to understand the concept also, how this peritoneum has developed, initially foregut, midgut and hindgut will have anterior and posterior borders. Where my hand is there, this is the anterior border, and here this is the posterior border. And we know the midgut loop. This is the midgut loop which is outside the abdominal cavity at this stage. Now, the anterior border of this entire gut tube is connected to the anterior abdominal wall. So, here if I draw the anterior abdominal wall, it is connected with the help of ventral mesogastrium during the embryological stages. So, ventral mesogastrium, now here if I show, this is ventral mesogastrium connecting the ventral border of the entire gut tube with anterior abdominal wall. Posteriorly, here if I draw the posterior abdominal wall, dorsal part, the posterior part of the gut tube will be connected to the posterior abdominal wall by the dorsal mesogastrium. Now, the ventral mesogastrium of midgut and hindgut will disappear. The ventral mesogastrium of the midgut as well as the hindgut will not be present. It will disappear. So here, there will not be presence of ventral mesogastrium now. So what we are left now in embryological stage, the ventral mesogastrium covering the foregut and the dorsal mesogastrium covering the foregut, midgut, hindgut. Dorsal mesogastrium, it will connect the dorsal border or posterior border of foregut, midgut, hindgut with the posterior abdominal wall, and ventral mesogastrium will connect the anterior border of the foregut with the anterior abdominal wall. Therefore, after some time, there will be development of liver where my hand is there in the ventral mesogastrium. So, in the ventral mesogastrium, now here, simply mentioning ventral mesogastrium, there will be development of the liver. So, at this point, there will be development of liver in ventral mesogastrium. So, the entire ventral mesogastrium, this fold of ventral mesogastrium connecting anterior abdominal wall with the ventral border of the foregut is divided by liver into anterior and posterior segment. The anterior segment between liver and anterior abdominal wall will develop. Now from this anterior segment, there will be development of falciform ligament and coronary ligaments of liver. So the falciform ligaments and coronary ligaments of the liver, they will develop from the anterior portion of ventral mesocastrium present between liver and anterior abdominal wall. Then the posterior portion of the ventral mesocastrium between liver and foregut. In future, this foregut will be developed into, this portion particular will develop into stomach. So here, this portion of the ventral mesocastrium between liver and foregut will develop into lesser omentum. See how easy and how clear this portion of development of this peritoneal folds is. Now coming to dorsal mesocastrium. Since dorsal mesocastrium is present throughout the entire length of foregut, midgut, hindgut, the dorsal mesocastrium will extend below the stomach. If this portion becomes the stomach, where my hand is there, a portion of it will extend beyond the stomach. And from this, first we will mention this as dorsal mesogastrium. So a portion of dorsal mesogastrium beyond the stomach. Now, for example, this portion of dorsal mesogastrium beyond the stomach will extend below and will develop into greater omentum. So it will develop into greater omentum. Then what happens? This greater omentum is in the caudal portion of the dorsal mesogastrium in the region of stomach. Now in the cranial portion, in the cranial portion of dorsal mesogastrium, there will be development of another organ, and that organ here, if I show, it will be known as spleen. Spleen develops in the dorsal mesogastrium in the cranial part. Therefore, that cranial portion of dorsal mesogastrium will be divided by development of spleen into ventral and dorsal portion. So this ventral portion in front of the spleen, it will develop into gastrosplenic ligament. So gastrosplenic ligament, what is the development? It is a peritoneal fold only, but it is derived from, it is developed from dorsal mesogastrium present between stomach, that is a foregut which develops into stomach, and spleen. Then we come to this area, this particular area, this portion of dorsal mesogastrium which is present between spleen and posterior abdominal wall, or the portion of dorsal mesogastrium which is present behind the spleen, will develop into two more ligaments, and those two ligaments will be leno-renal ligament and gastrophrenic ligament. The leno-renal ligament and gastrophrenic ligament, these two ligaments will develop from dorsal mesogastrium which is present between spleen and posterior abdominal wall. Then we come lower down, midgut, hindgut. The dorsal mesogastrium of this entire midgut and hindgut, remember, they will develop into, number one, transverse mesocolon. So now you can easily estimate transverse mesocolon suspending the transverse colon. It will also develop into another structure, that is mesentery of small intestine. It will also develop into the sigmoid mesocolon, and it will also develop into the mesentery covering appendix, and that mesentery covering appendix will be known as mesoappendix. So these are the peritoneal folds which will develop from dorsal mesogastrium which is present on midgut and hindgut, or the dorsal mesogastrium connecting midgut hindgut with the posterior abdominal wall. From that portion of the dorsal mesogastrium, the following folds of the peritoneum will develop. What are they? They are the transverse mesocolon, which will cover the transverse colon. They are the mesenteries, which will cover the coils of jejunum and ileum. They are the sigmoid mesocolon covering the sigmoid colon, and they are the mesentery of appendix, which will cover the appendix, vermiform appendix. So therefore, these peritoneal folds will develop from the dorsal mesogastrium of midgut and hindgut. So with this, we have understood the first segment of the peritoneal cavity. Here we end our part 1 of the peritoneal cavity. Thank you very much.